Hello, my audience. Once more, my name is Tindi Seje Nuru. I'm a transformational coach and a vitality coach. This beautiful day, I want us to continue our conversation around spenditude, a topic that I'm passionate about, and that which I talked about last in our last discussion. So this day, quickly, I want to make just a recap of our last talk. I was reminding you that it's very, very important that you think about your financial intelligence, so that you are able to, you know, take advantage of your finances. Now, I remember talking to you about a slender, a spender, and a defender, and we agreed that spenders spend without minding about their finances, whereas slenders are in between and defenders are very, very, very good with the money. We also talked about your Monday, Tuesday, up to your Friday weekend the next week. Monday being your teenage years, Tuesday your 20s, Wednesday your 30s, Thursday your 40s, Friday your 50s, over the weekend your 60s and 70s, your next weekend being when you are in your 80s and in the 90s. Now, today, I want to converse with you around what we call money narratives. It's very, very important that you know that there is a voice that always speaks to us inside our heads, and we can train this voice to have a different narrative, you know, so that we have a different narrative. By becoming aware of and changing of our internal narrative towards money, we can achieve better financial outcomes. Now, your money narrative is something you believe even when there is no one around you. So in identifying this narrative, you are able to decide if it serves you, you know, and explore ways of changing it. So it will be very, if you do this, it will bring you more confidence to avoid what we call FOMO, which is a form of fear of missing out, and fruitless social demands. Now, your narrative is influenced by your DNA and or your environment. So it means if you are, your parents were frugal and a bit tight ass with the money, maybe your money narrative equally may be built around that. Now, it's very, very important that you think about your thought becoming things. Do thought really become things? Now, if you believe you'll never win anything, then you probably won't. Again, if you believe you are destined to remain in your financial situation, then things are unlikely to change. It's note that the closer you are to understanding your own money narrative, the more easily you are able to ignore and avoid, you know, the noise in quotes. So you then become less susceptible to the triggers that will influence your financial decisions. Your money narrative affects the more automatic behaviors in your life and the more formal decisions you make towards your expenses. I wanted to remind you, folks, that it's very, very important that you hardwire this in your system, that you can change your money narrative and become a better version of yourself. You become a walking, talking, value-breeding machine as you add value to people around you, your intimate loved ones, and the general public at large. I wanted you to draw from this that a spender and lump sum are soon parted. Now, have you ever thought about winning a lottery and having spare cash? People often feel that having more money, you know, will enable them to refocus and spend without restrictions. They think that money will bring freedom, which I really don't believe. However, when you shift your financial position, for better or for worse, you realize that it doesn't change your personal money narrative. Now, data seems to suggest that lottery winners are more likely to file for bankruptcy than an average person. They can even struggle with mental health, and they're more susceptible to divorce, those who win lottery. This is because the concept also goes for retirees. Retirees are also falling for this trap. Most of us have no skill. This is because most of us have no skill in managing a lump sum. It seemed to fall through our fingers so very fast. So, my fine folks, remember, a spender and lump sum are soon parted. However much money you have, if you are a spender, it will soon flip through your fingers very fast and you won't know how it was spent. So can we consider the opportunity cost with money? You know, people who are in their weekends and or next weeks, that's those who are in their 60s, 70s, and maybe 80s and 90s, often talk about the house they should have bought or how they could have saved money, you know, what they would have done differently. Now, coulda, shoulda, and ulda are three little sisters, three wicked sisters that we do not need to be friends with, because they make us feel unfulfilled. So I want to invite you to replace them with baby step changes that you can make in your financial lives, so that you don't have to visit these three sisters, the coulda, shoulda, and ulda. Now, after you purchased something, do you have a sense of regret? This is a rhetorical question. This is what we call buyer's remorse. And buyer's remorse is a real thing, and we can all experience it, whether we are spenders, defenders, or slanders. But the next phase of your buyer's remorse is the rationalization part of it, where you try convincing yourself that your purchase decision was right, when actually indeed, you know, it was a wasted opportunity for saving. So don't let your brain play on you. The marketing we are exposed to builds in us what is called FOMO, the formula I talked about, fear of missing out. Our money narrative, combined with the pressure of marketing and our social networks, can make us believe that acquiring an item will bring happiness, when that's just an illusion. It's your ego screaming. Our brain may back this up with both our money narrative and a hit of dopamine. That if I just had this, the life will be better. Let me remind you, the act of acquiring an item may bring temporary sense of happiness, but it doesn't have a long-lasting effect. So the concept of cognitive dissonance is real, in that, you know, we tend to trade off spenditude with our sense of doing the right thing. So my fine folks and my audience, don't let your brain play a trick on you and leave you with a painful bias remorse. You won't like to be there. Maybe think about some food for thought here. Have you noted that some people are just better with money than others? Are you a spender yourself, or a slender, renting and getting annoyed that a neighbor who seemed to be doing so well, you get annoyed the neighbor who seemed to be doing so well and has two investment properties maybe, when they even earn less, much less than you do? Are those neighbors you feel bad about, are they drug dealers, or they just have a different approach to money? Well, why does it seem effortless for some, you know, to be financially intelligent? Does it concern you that time is ticking by and you haven't accumulated much asset? Well, if this sounds familiar, then it's possible you are a slender and you need to wear a value lens, and it's never too late. You can change your baby steps from baby steps and become a better version of yourself. So get this new reality. Kindly write down your narrative so it's a positive voice inside your head. Write down your money narrative so that it's a positive voice inside your head. Otherwise, this brings me to what I call the iceberg concept. Now, Mahatma Gandhi said that a man is but a product of his own thoughts. What he thinks, he becomes. So who are we to argue with Gandhi? You know, people only see part of your story. Think of an iceberg. You can only see 10% of the iceberg above water, right? What's on and above the surface is the only thing that is visible to you. Now, what's visible to you is your spenditude. The why that informs your spenditude makes up the 90% which is below the watermark that you need to think about. So it's deeply rooted in your past. It's your values, those deep influences that drive your needs, and they're often invincible, unfortunately. So your money narrative sits at the waterline, you know, mostly out of sight, but you can hear the noise and the hubaloos it creates. Remember the iceberg concept and do justice to it. So really, what inspires your spending? I wanted to invite you to an Australian study that was done in 2018. Now, the banks in Australia reported that 86% of us don't know how much we spend per month. And an old saying goes, your bank and calendar don't lie. So if you review them, you'll see what you are doing with your time and money. This is how we dig to find the gold, the truth of where you're placing your own value. So tracking your expenses and your spending can be very, very interesting. It can help bring about clarity. What if your bank statement and calendar could reflect something that you like, something that you are proud of? So I want to invite you, friends, to always use budgeting tools to create awareness. You know, in the world we live in today, it's driven by consumerism. So success at times tends to be defined by our income levels and stuff like that. So we are likely to align our job titles, our social status, as well as our being in the community to our self-esteem and values. It's very, very important that you know that this is very, very, very dangerous. So we are so influenced by likes in social media that some of us spend a fortune just to get positive responses. In fact, some of us prefer these likes to cash, and unfortunately. Now, when you're trying to make a change, you should try and be focused on the big game. If you're addressing the 90% that is underwater that we talked about, you can really make a big leap more quickly if you address them. But habit change is a difficult beast. It seems easy until you start, then it's hijacked by our daily lives and social patterns. But comparing your motivators, as an individual, that is your needs, your drivers and values, to your time and money reality is the first step that you will ever make towards identifying your underwater part of the iceberg, the 90%, you remember? Now, how do you really make these decisions to spend? You realize that every purchase we make is driven by the way we prioritize four key factors. That is your monetary factor, functional factor, psychological factor, as well as social factors. Now, spenders and slenders and defenders all prioritize this differently. The order in which you consider this apply will push you or pull you away from the purchase. Spenders are most likely to place more emphasis on the social and the psychological worth of what they're buying, the purchase. They want to look good, maybe, and this drives the purchase. And so they forget about the functional value of the shirt. Maybe if it's about taking good food for their meals, they may go to a high-end restaurant, and that is to them trendy. That is to them really fulfilling their ego, massaging their ego. But defenders, on the other hand, prioritize the functional and monetary worth ahead of social and psychological influences. So they ask themselves, is it a good financial choice? Will it bring me value over time? Is it the most functional option available on table? And will it last? So, like I said again, when buying a shirt, my dear viewers, do you prioritize its function or the social value? That's for you to answer. I'm not so sure about what your position is. But you'll note that individuals who are clear about their values have higher levels of commitment, pride, and happiness in their work, which is very, very important. So the baseline is, too often, we equate our self-worth with our net worth, which is an illusion, Comparison is the thief of joy. So run your own race. Avoid comparison. We all have different mountaintops. It will be terrible to spend all your energy climbing, running towards the mountaintop, only to reach the top and find that you climbed the wrong mountain, Comparing yourself with others will steal your money and happiness and your joy. Please challenge your thoughts about money and look for opportunities to be grateful. The people we are hypnotized to admire have a lot of things they're struggling with. And it's like they take good care of the base of Maslow's hierarchy before climbing up, which is not the case with the most spenders and slenders. So loving your decisions come with knowing who you are and your deep motivators that make you spend the way you spend. A sense of confidence comes when you know who you are and what motivates you. Always remember, men, that bang, you are on your own path and no one else. So run your own race. Please wire that reality in you. You know, taking you back to Maslow's hierarchy, spenders and slenders find their motivation to move up the Maslow's hierarchy happening a little too quickly. You know Maslow's hierarchy with psychological, basic needs and the second need, the five needs with self-transcendence up there. But defenders are more focused because they are good with money. They are aware of their needs and they don't climb Maslow's hierarchy ladder too quickly. You know, they prioritize the drivers. They know the value of patience. Patience pains, but it pays. So be true to what makes you true. You know, understand your deep motivators and values so that you become so very true to them. Now, we would want to create awareness so that we are aware of ourselves and our what inspires our expenses. You know, awareness is key. If you are aware of your spenditude, values, and narratives, you are in so much a position to make better choices and changes. Awareness makes you have better choices, of course. It will also reduce the risk of insanity. There is this quote that if you do the same thing the same way every day and you are expecting a different result, then you are insane, incredibly insane. But so if you're aware of your spenditude, then you reduce the risk of insanity. So please, if you're aware of your expenses, you will improve your spenditude. Now, moving into this third decade of new millennium, the only constant will be more changes as the digital revolution is taking place and the political uncertainty continues to, be rampant in our paths. The future is very exciting and so very scary to so very many. So please, let's consider these five nuggets that will help you create awareness that would want to empower you with. Now, the first nugget is that you should make a little plan and pivot. If you want to be aware of your financial position, make a little plan and pivot. You know, creating an awareness by making a plan is very, very critical. This brings us to goal setting. Goal setting is a powerful tool that you can leverage on to increase your chances at anything, And research shows that you increase your odds by about 42% when you write down your goals. Now, sharing your goals with a critical friend or your intimate loved ones may increase this percentage further. So when we set big goals without small milestones and opportunity to celebrate wins, then we are likely to fail. Having set the milestone, please break them down, put those low-hanging fruits that you can always leverage on along the way. We all need positive feedback and reinforcement, so as to succeed. We would want to continue if we see more immediate results. So please set yourself a realistic challenge. If you set yourself a goal and you fall off the wagon along the way, you realize that you are the one in control of your response, you see? So don't you quit because you just made one mistake from your path or you're pivoting on. Ask, what can you do to increase your chances of making your plan stick if your plan is not working? Writing down is great, but it's imperative that you add many action plans that will help you make these changes come true. What are your day-to-day plans like? What are the challenges ahead that you can wrap your brain around and, jump over? The second nugget that we could share is that you should spend less than you earn. I mean, this is big stuff. This is the real oxygen that drives wealth creation and the real key to financial success. Track your expenses, considering your controllables. Those are the things you have control over, like your wants, like today just had an ice cream, that's my want, and your inevitables. These are your needs, basic needs, like house, shelter, and shelter, food, and clothing, as well as your spending, discretionary spending. This will be like your passion spending. If you play golf, if you whatever you spend on, maybe football, I'm not so sure, but that's discretionary spending. So track your expenses, look at your controllables, like your wants, inevitables, like your needs, as well as your passion spending, what I call discretionaries or your passion spending. Value what you spend on. Try to put a value lens. How many months' rent is it worth, what you're spending on right now? Is my purchase based on genuine need or sociocultural pressure? Is there a cheaper alternative, and will it last? So finding a greater intention in your consumer habits will support your financial outcomes and probably help you spend much less than you earn. Fine colleagues, making choices on how you spend your money will include the opportunity to be satisfied with what you have. Choosing enjoyment and giving and having the strength to say no is very, very important. Therefore, every time you say no to something that is very important to you, you are saying yes to something that is toxic to your survival. And the reverse is equally true. The third nugget I will want to talk about is leveraging on the quote from Einstein. Now, Einstein gives us a second quote here. And the quote says that compound interest is the eighth wonder of the world. He who understands it, earns it. He who doesn't, pays it. So, we learn about compound interest in schools. I want to thank God for those curriculum. But do we really comprehend how it plays in our money and wealth creation lives? Beyond classrooms. Money placed into retirement, therefore retirement fund, in the earlier years of your career has bigger earning potential, But it's the second part of the quote that is less obvious to the simple majority. Paying interest on debt, be it credit card or your mortgage, is essentially paying compound interest, if you didn't know. Now, the earlier you make extra payments, the bigger the impact. The earlier you make extra repayments to your debts, the bigger the impact. In the same way, the interest earned on saving account will have an upward swing over time. So please think about Einstein's second quote. Compound interest is the eighth wonder of the world. He who understands it, earns it. He who doesn't understand it, pays it. And that is the painful truth. Now, fourthly, the fourth nugget is that you benchmark with Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett is one of the greatest financial gurus of our time. His rule number one is never lose money. Rule number two, don't forget rule number one. He says that please avoid gambling. Invest in something you understand. So do research and be informed before you invest in anything. Some people are very good at saving. Others are good at paying debt. I don't know what you are, but savers tend to preserve their savings for intended use, even when they are holding debts, and that's very, very important. I don't know whether you are a saver or a debtor. But when it comes to saving, remember that cash savings are not investments. Over time, inflation depreciates the value of cash we have in the banks. But also remember that bad debt is borrowing for assets that lose value immediately, like buying a new car, number plate. Every time a number plate comes, you buy a new car. Every time a new phone, latest Samsung Galaxy in town, you go for it. But A good debt, if you want to accrue debt, good debt is borrowing to fund, you know, good debt is borrowing to fund or create assets, like when you buy a parcel of land or plot in town. Having said all this, I must remind you that debt is a friend and an enemy at the same time. So it's a frenemy, perhaps, you know, understand it and use it well. Our fifth and the last nugget here is that be mindful. Now, mindfulness is the practice of bringing your attention to the present. It's about reconnecting with the positive aspects of your life, like your health, family, and friendship. Practicing gratitude for what you have is one key simple way to hardwire your brain for more gratefulness, kindness, and happiness. Now, mindfulness can help us see why we are really spending the way we do and deal with our spending habits appropriately. It can help us make better decisions by allowing us to live in the moment, you know. Now, when you're thinking about spending, mindfulness will allow you to notice where your mind is. Remember, I told you I'm a transformational coach, and at times I do intuitive guides. I provide intuitive guides, and this is one of my strengths, I think, when I'm always advising my clients. I really want to pray that you leverage your best strength, because I say that I'm a strength advocate. So as I conclude, please let me quickly take you through some mundane money-saving tips. One of them is mindfulness that I've talked about. The second one, do a fast with something that you spend a lot on. If you spend a lot on smoking or drinking or whatever it is, can you fast so that you hit some goals, then you periodically go to it? Another way is to do weekly or monthly journaling. Another way will be to create a plan and set specific goals that you must hit. Another way will be to use cash. You know, the pain of paying in cash is real. So if you went with a credit card, you can swap, always swap. Like I, at times, I am forced to hold the hand of my wife when we walk in the supermarket. Not because the card is real, but it looks romantic. But I'm also holding her hand so that she doesn't pick anything anyhow, because ultimately I'm the one to pay. Well, again, another way to save money is to use your presence and not present, especially for our children and our intimate loved ones. Again, be a cheerleader. Depend on cheerleaders. Tell your plan, your financial saving plans to your intimate loved ones so that they become your cheerleaders. They help you save. Finally, round it off. Each and every time you check into your account, if there is $5,200, put $200 into the savings account. If there is $1,200, put $200 saving accounts. If there is $750, put $50 to the savings account. That is what we call rounding off. Finally, gratitude. Be grateful and remove resentfulness, because this is toxic and will help you become more toxic to yourself. Finally, sleep better and consider the economic cost of good sleep. I hope I've been of service to you. Thank you so very much, and I hope I want to leave you with one mental tattoo, brain tattoo, and the tattoo is that ideation without execution is delusion. Please don't ideate, execute. Let's meet at the top, because it's crowded at the bottom. Thank you. I remain Tindi.